Maestro wasn't the first fuzz pedal ever made, but it was the first to become commercially available. Its design was based on DIY circuits that came before it, and basically every pedal since has been based on it. In business, we call any product that copies and improves previous products leapfrogs. The small and incremental innovations are the engines of evolution. For example, a year before Don't Worry by Marty Robbins came out, Lee Hazelwood asked a radio station technician to make a custom preamp circuit to be used in the studio. It was used on Sanford Clark's 1960 song, Go On Home.
I didn't do that time just for shooting dice. I wasn't looking for trouble.
First of all, I listened to that on the reg. If you ain't hip to Sanford Clark, go search him on Spotify. Sanford Go Hard. This is believed to be the first record to feature a custom preamp circuit, but there are no pictures, detailed descriptions, or schematics of the elusive circuit. Perhaps when Marty Robbins was recording Don't Worry a few months later, the engineer was inspired by Sanford Clark. A few months later, after Don't Worry hit the radio, Orville Rhodes created his own DIY Broken Circuits, used by Billy Strange and the Ventures in 1961 for the song 2,000 Pound Beat. This became known as the Red Road Circuit. No production version of the pedal was ever made, although Orville made several of these boxes for fellow musicians, including The Ventures, Billy Strange, and Noki Edwards. Fast forward 1 year, Gibson became the first mover in the transistor circuit guitar effects pedal space on October 19th, 1962. For the next decade or so, we see an astronomical explosion of leapfrogs and substitutes that we'll look at in the next few videos. For all you gearheads, the Maestro featured three germanium transistors. And for all you noobs, transistors control the flow of electric current. When you link them up with a network of resistors and capacitors, you get a circuit. It's kind of like a miniature version of what's going on in your actual speaker amp. The preamp circuit seasons your guitar signal. Imagine you're making ramen, okay? Some circuits are like adding cayenne pepper. Others are like adding jalapeno. In a few episodes, we'll be up to, say, habanero. By the end of the series, we'll be taking full bites of a Trinidad scorpion pepper, and liking it too. Now that's some magma quality ramen. A fuzz pedal, by definition, is two or more transistors, feeding back into each other, boosting the signal in various manners. Now, depending on the values in which you set capacitors, which store a specific amount of electric charge, and resistors, which resist the passage of electric charge, you get completely different character out of the same transistors. Plus, these early germanium transistors were temperature sensitive. There's a famous story of Duane Allman putting his fuzz in the freezer right before recording, as he swore it made it sound better. And he was probably right, especially in that Jacksonville heat. Germanium fuzz boxes were known to be unusable at outdoor summer gigs, or wherever it was blaringly hot. And I don't know how much you know about Jacksonville, but it's hotter than Satan's house cat in a paper patch. So, in a few episodes, we'll see silicon transistors fix that problem. We'll also see how overloading different transistors gives you different tones of distortion. Now, I highly recommend looking into the science of how a transistor actually functions. Super interesting stuff. Link in the description, fam. Get learned every day. Anyway, these early fuzz circuits were mostly meant for the bass, attempting to emulate the Don't Worry bass solo. In fact, the Maestro circuit even made it onto the actual body of Gibson's EBOF fuzz basses in 1964. For the first 3 years that the Maestro was available, sales were shit. Nobody had made emulator boxes cool just yet. But when Keith Richards' opening note to the Stones' insanely successful single hit radios on May 10th, 1965, fuzz was suddenly cooler than the Fonz in Siberia. In the next 5 years, 30 of the greatest guitar pedals, even to this day, were created. It was the age of leapfrogs. Again, a leapfrogger adds small innovations to an existing product and sells it as their own. Now let's try to think like a leapfrogger in 1964. The Maestro was selling well, but it kinda sounded like shit at the same time. In retrospect, that's probably why it's so great, but if you compare the Maestro to any other subsequent 1960s fuzzes, it sounds extremely thin and buzzy. Also, they couldn't keep up with production, which meant more people wanted it than there were available. It only had two knobs, one for volume and one for what they called attack. but it was basically a fuzz knob though. It changed how hard the circuit would clip the signal. They probably called it attack because of the sag that soft clipping adds. The race was on to outdo the maestro.
On your marks! Get set!